Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I welcome everyone to the house of the Lord. It's good to be with you today. Hope you're blessed by worship. Hope you feel God draw near to you as well. And I'd like to welcome everyone in person and online. We're going to start off with a few announcements. Our next church council meeting is on December the 11th. That's a Sunday, so that'll be after worship. Our play practice is coming up on December 4th. That's going to start at 5 p.m. And I believe our first play practice is today at 4 p.m. So if you're in the play, and you can make it today to the play practice, that is at 4 p.m. today. We're also going to be going Christmas caroling on Sunday the 11th at 5 p.m. There's also going to be, we'll have food after caroling. So come on out for that. It's a fun and joyful event. We'll go caroling and then join together back at the community building for a meal together. If you've been attending worship services lately and are interested in joining the church, we're going to have an informational membership meeting after worship today. It will be brief, and so if you would like to come to that, I'll invite you to that. Also, if you're interested in reading one of the Advent wreath readings, please sign up for that. That is out front. We're not going to have one today. We don't have any candles, so we'll do two. We'll double up next week. So if you'd like to do the first week, you still can. We'll do it next week. I was about to read the right, same one. Open house at the Parsonage will be on Friday, December the 16th. That'll be from 6 to 8:30, and there will be food. There always is. So come on out for that. All are invited. We'll have a good time fellowshipping at that. We still need children's story volunteers, so please go sign up for that out front. And Grace is still in need of volunteer help with the children during church downstairs. As always, our Sunday sermons are uploaded on YouTube. You can catch that online at YouTube, or even I try and post those sometimes on Facebook as well. I believe the link is on Facebook if you're on Facebook. And you don't have to be a member of YouTube. Like you can send that link of that sermon to anybody. You can text it to them, and they can watch it on their phone. They don't have to have a computer. They can watch it on their computer. So it's a lot easier for us to share the Sunday sermons or devotionals, which we'll be having some Advent devotionals that I'll be talking about today as well during worship. And also, we're still collecting food and crackers for the food bank at Maple Springs. The next giveaway is Tuesday, December the 20th. So please be mindful of that, as well as our hygiene products for students for the Others program. Are there any other announcements we need to mention this morning?
I've got one.
Hey, go ahead.
The next Saturday night at the Reeves Theater, I'm helping to produce and singing in a show there. It's a fundraiser for the Reeves Downtown School of Music. And everybody here is probably familiar with my friend Amy. Amy's coming up to sing in it with me, so it'll be me and Amy. And you don't have to go to Blowing Rock. You can just go to Elko. There are still some tickets available in the balcony. They're very reasonable, and it is a fundraiser. Also, if you're a student, there's a discount. If you're a senior, there's a discount. You're supposed to ask for it when you call and ask. So there are a few more details on Facebook and on the Reeves website, but it's next Saturday night at 7 o'clock at the Reeves, the Reeves Theater there in downtown Elkin. I just want to make sure everybody knew about that.
Well, thank you, Christmas.
And my friend Steve's coming over to play. So.
Awesome.
There'll be several people. It'll be just Disney and Broadway music.
Wonderful. Well, thank you, Chris. That's wonderful. It's something wonderful to look forward to. Any other announcements we need to mention this morning? Any other announcements? If there are no other announcements, I invite you to prepare your hearts for worship this morning.
Thank you.
us join together in our call to worship, standing as you're able, and sing, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. We'll be singing verses 1 through 4. And let's turn to page 211, or the words may be on your screen. 211, we'll see the first four verses.
Thank you. made it through the week with a full house of people and dogs. So thank y'all for your prayers. With that, Mom's not here today. Her back's a bother, so please say an extra prayer for her on that. And I ask y'all to pray for my new great nephew, great cousin, whatever he is to me. He's still doing okay. They tried to get a pig line in him the other night, and his oxygen level was a little bit low. He has gained a little bit of weight. He's still at a pound something, but he's a fighter. So right now, God's still in control. So just continue to add him to your prayers. His name again is called Valor, but he's a fighter. So, and I noticed that y'all did put Frank Alexander on the prayer chain for me. Thank y'all very much. He passed away about a week ago. However, he's in a better place. He knew he was going to a better place. He, in fact, told his wife he would be waiting for her when she got there. So thank y'all so much for your prayers for his family.
All right. Let's continue to keep both those families in our prayers. Any others this morning?
I have a couple of praise reports. My cousin, who we've been praying for, her son is still in the hospital, but the doctors have mentioned going home.
All right.
So
praise
hopefully
the
that
Lord.
Will be soon. And her sister, welcome her second child this week.
All right. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Grace. Good reports. That's good. Any others today?
Steve, Sherb's brother, made it down here all in one piece, although traffic was horrid. So we're glad to have him back.
Our prayers as they travel back. Any others this morning?
Keep me in your prayers as I leave early Wednesday morning, like at 3 a.m., and I'll be back the following Thursday. I'm heading to see my little baby.
Be praying for travels for you, Kathy. Any others?
Pastor Matt, I don't really have to say this, to be honest with you. And December the 5th, I'll be 60 years old. I mean, it just, it don't seem right. But I've just got such a blessing sitting here on this road. And I just don't know how to praise enough to what he's done and what he's gave me from the time I was 34 years old.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you for sharing.
I just want to say that we had a great Thanksgiving get together at Tommy and Lena's, and I'm thankful for that, for family.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you for sharing. Any others?
I think everybody had a good Thanksgiving, especially that turkey and gravy.
Oh, the gravy is the best. You can make the best gravy.
Any others?
Josh, too. He is a rodeo star. You ever watched him get brought off or thrown off bulls, bareback, whatever it takes? He's got it. And as for one, I'm really proud of him.
Yeah. I appreciate it.
Thanks for Matt. With that to be added, I'm going to brag on him just a little bit.
Go ahead.
He finished up 100th in the world this year.
Wow.
He don't seem like that much.
Travel mercies for everybody that's traveling. But
everybody.
My group will be leaving Joseph on Monday. He's a truck driver, so I always keep him in your prayers. Livia's going back to college today, and I think Josh is leaving right. End of next week.
End of next week. Sometime.
So. And whoever bought the tree, thank you very much for a gorgeous tree.
Beautiful, man.
I think that's good stuff.
I think so.
It's always that one. It's always that one.
It's pretty, but it's
beautiful. Any others this morning?
Travel mercies. Everybody's traveling this time of year. Truck drivers included. Well, everybody's driving now. You got everybody going to Christmas, and everybody's going home for Thanksgiving, so yep. Keep everybody in your prayers.
Yeah, we'll be keeping that in our prayers. Thank you for sharing. Any others this morning?
Yeah, I can pass my kidney stone.
Yeah, Katie's, keep Katie in your prayers. She seems to be having another kidney stone. This is familiar territory for her, but thankfully she's been a year and a half without one. So, any others this morning? I think somebody was going
to say something. Hey, I just want to add to the thankfulness of God and His grace. And we were blessed to have a Thanksgiving celebration. We didn't have turkey again. We were trying to have chicken stew, but Kim and his family and, came over and for about 4 hours, so it was a true blessing. His praise or his prayer is that he can make it through Christmas this year. So keep him playing. And Gabriel has another court date as of the 30th this week. So please keep him lifted up in your prayers and us as well.
Okay. Thank you for sharing. Definitely keep all those in our prayers. Any others this morning?
I guess I'm a praise dinner. Yeah. So I'm almost done with my first semester, but I think I'm going to change my major.
Okay.
So I don't know what to yet, but I'm sure I'll figure it out.
Definitely keep you in your prayers. Hopefully the Lord gives you discernment. Any others? Let's go before the Lord in prayer. I invite you to take whatever posture of prayer you'd love to take. This altar is always open. Give me a few moments of silent prayer, and then I will lead us together. Let's pray. Counselor, you are our Prince of Peace. Lord, we give you praise today for the many blessings. We give you thanks for all the ways that you have been good to us and how you are a good God. Lord, we lift up these prayer requests to you. Father, each of them are dear to our hearts. Lord, we lift them up and ask that you would answer them according to your love and will, and those who are in need of safety, Lord, that you would provide safe paths for them to travel. Lord, that you'd be continually bringing about healing, restoration for those who are sick, those who are ill. Lord, may you be working in those people's lives that we lifted up today that are in need of a touch of your grace. We pray all this, Lord, and as we turn our hearts to you during this Advent season, may you give us hope anew. May this season be fresh, full of passion and love for you, full of devotion towards you and your kingdom. And may we arrive at Christmas being revived, being inspired. May we also be empowered to be your people here on earth, your body of Christ, redeemed for the world. We give you praise. I pray all this in Jesus' name. And join in the prayer that you taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now it's time where we worship the Lord through the givings of our tithes and our offerings. Have our ushers come down at this time.
Thank you.
these gifts to you. May they bless your holy name, and Lord, may we continue to be faithful stewards of all that you've blessed us with as your children. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I believe it's time for the children's story. Do we have a children's story this morning? Do we have a children's story? I don't know if we have a children's story. Jordan may just be you. Do you have one, Grace? Okay, all right, come on down, kids.
I'm waiting for Mommy, because I want to sit in Mommy's lap. Not until you sit. But I want...
All right. Good morning.
Right in front of Mommy.
Did everybody have a good Thanksgiving?
Uh-huh.
All right. So, with the big Christmas tree and the start of the Advent calendars, it is officially the Christmas season, right?
Where it's about to be. There's no holiday going on right now.
Right, but it's the Christmas, even though it's not Christmas Day, it's the Christmas season. So, there are many traditions that we have in the Christmas season, right? You may have traditions in your house, like matching Christmas pajamas, or at our house,
a Christmas party or
a Christmas party or a Christmas cake. At our house, we do a scavenger hunt and look for a Christmas present. We have all
early
Christmas present. That's
on my little sister's birthday.
There are lots of Christmas traditions, but as we enter this season, it's important to remember the true reason for the season. And who can tell me what's the true reason for the season?
Jesus' birthday.
In this season, we remember that this season is all about Jesus and the gift that he gave us when he first came. So let's say a prayer. Dear God, thank you so much for this season. Thank you for all the fun things that we get to experience because of Jesus. Help us to keep him in the center of it all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Mary Jane.
Let's join together in worship again. Our hymn of preparation is O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. We'll be singing verses 5 through 7 this time. That's on page 211. Verses 5 through 7.
Thank you.
chapter 9, beginning with verse 2. Isaiah chapter 9, beginning with verse 2. We're going to be reading verses 2 through 7. Hear the word of the Lord this morning. The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light. Those who live in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nations. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult with dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken, as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the trampling warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and his name is Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness for this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of the hosts will do this. This is the word of God for the whole world of God.
Thanks be to God.
Well, I wanted to do something different this year for Advent. I wanted a different theme. I always try and do it. This year's theme is going to be Advent in Narnia. You ever heard of Narnia? Y'all know the Chronicles of Narnia? We're going to be traveling through Narnia a little bit. And we're going to be mainly focusing on the first book. There will be some comments probably from some of the other books that the author, C.S. Lewis, wrote. But if you want to watch the movies, go ahead and watch them. If you want to read the book, go ahead and read the book. I'm going to be uploading devotionals this Advent. Hopefully one every day. We'll see how that goes. I know that's they're going to be short, okay? Short videos that you can watch and follow along with. There'll be times when you can read certain chapters and follow along with those devotionals, but you don't have to. Here's the beauty about this story. It's simple enough that you don't have to read or watch the movies. I think there's two movies you can watch online that you can actually watch the old BBC movies, which I grew up with, on YouTube. And I think on Disney Plus, they have the movies you can stream. The books are easy to find, the movies are easy to find, but you don't have to. The imageries, the metaphors, the illustrations are simple enough, I think, for anyone to understand it and ponder Advent differently this time of year. But our first Sunday is themed the lamppost. If you've heard of or read the story, you may know where this is going, may know remember the lamppost. But this story, the Chronicles of Narnia, especially The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, which is what we're going to focus on, the way the author, C.S. Lewis, wrote it, he wrote it with purpose. He believed, and I mentioned this in my introductory video to devotionals, he wrote his story with such purpose that, and you really can see this, he believed that no fictional story was truly fictional. He believed that all fictional stories had truth in them, and that's what made them valuable. Because those truths, those stories can tell us deeper truths about life, about God. That's what he believed. And that's why C.S. Lewis, I believe, that's how C.S. Lewis wrote such a powerful story when you begin to look at the images he used. The story follows these four children, these four siblings. Their names are Peter, Susan, Edmund, and Lucy. Lucy's the youngest. They are the, I think their last name is Pevensey Kids. It's the Pendencies, yeah. They are living during World War II. They're sent to the countryside during the raids in London. They live in London. Their mom has sent them away to stay safe in the countryside at this old professor's mansion. Imagine this mansion like the Biltmore House. It's huge. For four children, it would be, they'd have a heyday, right, in exploring. There's only three other staff there and then the old professor. So imagine living in the Biltmore House with just eight people. You wouldn't probably see each other unless you had dinner all day. But these children, as they begin to explore, one of them, Lucy, the youngest, happens across a wardrobe in a spare room. And something calls her to enter that wardrobe. And she does. And as she does, and she's sort of peeling back the fur coats, which she loves, Something happens. She begins to feel a cool breeze. She hears the crunch of something beneath her feet. She feels prickly branches. She emerges from the wardrobe, having been transported or walking into a new world, a world called Narnia. She doesn't know that at the time, but she has traveled into a world that's connected to our world, Earth. But Narnia is sort of, as Lewis wrote it, is this reflection of our world in fairy tale manner. She quickly meets a person, an inhabitant of the land, but something draws her to continue traveling further into Narnia. There's a light that she sees as she steps into this forest at night with its snow-covered ground and limbs. She sees this light that beckons her to come further. And so she does. She travels and finds a lamppost. Now that is a strange sight to see in any woods, to see a long lamppost by itself burning with no fuel or electricity, but it's there. And oddly enough, it only has one post as well. But there it stands in the middle of the forest. And as she meets this other character, whose name is Tumnus, Mr. Tumnus, he's a faun. He tells her about this lamppost. He's surprised to see what he calls a daughter of Eve, a human child. And there's reasons for that that we'll probably discuss later on. But he tells her that this lamppost is the sort of boundary, the marker for the land of Narnia. It's the end of Narnia and the beginning of the wild woods of the West. But more importantly, Lucy learns that this lamppost is a symbol for something. It once was brought from Earth to the land of Narnia. And you find out in another book how it came to be in Narnia. It was the lamppost had been used by a villain as a weapon. And as it arrived in Narnia, the king of Narnia, the creator of all of Narnia, took that lamppost and made it into something new. An actual lamppost, but a symbol. A symbol that one day he would return and save the land of Narnia from this villain. The villain is the White Witch. She believes herself to be queen, and it is her that has cast a spell over Narnia and caused it to be winter. And that is what has happened. The people of Narnia live in a constant state of winter. It's always winter in Narnia, Mr. Tumnus says. It's never Christmas. What a horrible state to live in. Where it's always winter. It's always dead. It's always overcast or snowy. I don't know about you, but living in Kentucky, they are one of the nation's most highest levels of seasonal depression because they have the most overcast days. It was tough sometimes not seeing the sun. Imagine that, never seeing the sun. Always overcast, always cloudy, always snowing. Never Christmas. But that lamppost was a sign for all of the people of Narnia that one day, the ruler, Aslan the Lion, who is C.S. Lewis wrote to be a representative of God, Jesus Christ. In fact, he makes some pretty obvious connections to that. He even says so in very metaphorical ways. But this symbol can never be extinguished. This lamppost, it doesn't need fuel. It has not been conquered by the witch's spell. It continually burns, always reminding them that one day Aslan will return to save the people. In our book, in Isaiah chapter 9, this is a song that is written, but it's a song of hope. It's a song that's written in the spirit of Advent. In Isaiah, this song speaks about another symbol, a great light in the darkness. Just like the people in Narnia were always under the threat of the White Witch and war and death, so are the people of Israel. They are under siege constantly at this point by empires that are powerful, more powerful than they are. The Assyrian Empire, the Babylonian Empire, and finally the Persian Empire. All threaten them, and eventually all of them conquer them at some point in time. And they will continue to rule. each of these empires. The people of Israel will continue to live under evil rulers during various times in history. After those empires comes Rome, and Rome rules over them as well. But the people of Israel, they suffer. They continually live in a land that feels like it's always winter. There is no hope, it seems like. Yet Isaiah speaks, when he speaks about this darkness, it's not this, when he speaks about this light conquering the darkness, it is not an optimistic hope of what might happen. Isaiah is speaking about a promise that has been given. And this darkness, when Scripture talks about darkness in this way, it's never literal. It's this heaviness, a deep fear of losing everything or losing everyone with no power to stop it. In fact, darkness is a deeper metaphor for depression and death as well. And some of your translations, if you read along with me this morning, may even have said, dwellers in a land of in a land as dark as death. Right? They may have translated that passage as that. Isaiah contrasts this darkness with this great, beautiful light. A light that as it shines forth, it not only conquers death, it brings hope and joy and peace. That's why this passage is so powerful and is so... It fits so well with Advent. Those are our themes, right? This is the first week of Advent, where we focus on the theme of hope. That's what this lamppost in Narnia means. That's what this light that Isaiah is singing about represents. Light of hope. A light that will, when it comes, conquer darkness, conquer death. It symbolizes life, joy, and hope, and peace. But there's also this celebration that happens when this light comes. In verse 3, it talks about how it says that God increases the nation's joy. They rejoice with joy as like the joy with harvest time, celebrating victory. We just had Thanksgiving. Right? It fits. We see this image of people celebrating. And when the winter dove is broken in the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, all the people begin to celebrate. When Christmas comes, they all throw feasts to celebrate that Aslan, God, is on his way. This light that Isaiah speaks about is like this lamppost in Narnia. It's this living thing. No one lights it, no one extinguishes it, it burns without fuel. The witch's winter hasn't conquered it or snuffed it out. C.S. Lewis uses this image of a lamppost as a promise. And he uses the character of Aslan as a symbolic representation of Christ. Aslan will come and save the world and will make a sacrifice to save us from our sins. Aslan can make anything that's broken new, whole, and alive. It is this beacon in the face of dark, cold spells that lie over the land. It is a symbol of hope. But that is our Savior, Jesus Christ. In verse 6, he is our wonderful counselor, our mighty God, our everlasting Father, and our Prince of Peace. And when he comes, he will redeem and restore all that is broken and all that is lost. You know, during Advent, we light our own symbols of hope. We put lights on the Christmas trees. We maybe use lights around wreaths, and we have wreaths and evergreen. We light these Advent candles. Each candle represents, I know we don't have them today, but each candle, each week represents a different thing, aspect of Advent. But we light these symbols of hope. We light those Advent candles. Just like that lamppost, we carry those symbols of hope, of Christ's light all year around. All these symbols remind us of the promise of God, our Savior. Jesus who came, Jesus who died, Christ who is risen, Jesus Christ who will come again. God will keep that promise. And it's in that hope that we hear these songs of Isaiah. And when you read the Gospel of Luke, you read the song of Zechariah. It has this hope as he sees right before his very eyes the promises of God coming true, that he would send a Messiah to save them. That is why he sings his song. That is the hope that the the citizens of Narnia live in as well, as they begin to see the spell and the power of the White Witch be destroyed. We are given this promise that no matter how dark things might get, no matter how fearful the days might be, no matter how frightened we might be, no matter how weak we are, the light of God reminds us that He can be trusted. He is our wonderful counselor. He has already come to save the world, and He will one day return. And when He came, part of Advent isn't just about reflecting on how God saved us and how God came to earth as a human, being born as a child. It also reminds us of what He taught us, how He taught us to live. And when He did come, He taught us how to love, what that looked like, to love God and to love neighbor. He showed us that He was the way to life everlasting. He is our wonderful counselor, our Prince of Peace. And when our Prince of Peace came, He drove out the demons, He healed illnesses, He flipped over the tables of greed in the temple, so that others might not be excluded. Our everlasting Father took on flesh, as one biblical translation says, and moved into the neighborhood. He lived with us. He taught us that blessed are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Each and every one of us know what it feels like to long for hope. There's that emptiness in our stomachs that when we've lost something or someone, we know the experience of crying tears, longing for things to be different, longing for the way life should be. We also know that excitement, that catch in our breath, that rapid heartbeat, excitement in our voice at the possibility of something new, the experience of something wonderful. That is the Christmas season, that there is hope in the world. It's not found in power. It's not found in nations or governments. It's not found in earthly leaders. That is the hope that C.S. Lewis writes about, as each character begins to experience God working in their life. The promise of seeing that promise of Aslan come and return. We cannot find this hope on our own, but it is in God, in the light of His good and vast grace that draws us to Him. It's a beautiful metaphor as you read how Lucy is drawn to the wardrobe and drawn to the light. Something magical beckons her. Yeah, it's normal for kids to be curious about what's inside a wardrobe, but something more draws, something greater than just curiosity draws Lucy to Narnia. That is an image of God's grace. It is God's grace that awakens us to the possibility that there is something more to life than things that waste away. God is begging for us to step into a new world full of life, to see the world. You see, our world is like the world of Narnia. It may not be full of dwarves and centaurs and fauns and talking lions or beavers or white witches, but it is a land of darkness. It's a land where it's always winter and never Christmas. You see, while we have experienced the hope of Christmas, we still live in a world that is broken, that is fallen, that is sinful, that needs to be redeemed. And it is only the power of Jesus Christ who can melt that snow of death in our lives and bring Christmas to us for the first time. It is only Christ who is our wonderful counselor, our mighty God, our everlasting Father, our Prince of Peace, who will come. He will break the weapons of war, bring righteousness, justice, and peace. This is Advent, where we join our voices with the voices of the Israelites long ago, as they sang songs of hope, longing for their Messiah to come. Even though Christ has come, we are still waiting as well for Him to return. We're waiting for Christmas. We're waiting for Aslan. We're waiting for Christ to return. But just like they had a lamppost to guide them, so do we. Our lamppost isn't our politics, it's not our weapons of war, it's not our own intellect and knowledge. It's the Christ child. And the fact is that when He does come, He will bring it into the world's ways, the world's politics, the world's weapons, the world's wars, the world's suffering. It reminds us that if God longs to bring those things to an end, so should we. And we should be very careful to cling too tightly to those things. So where do we look? We look towards the hope of our salvation. Read the scriptures, the Holy Scriptures that God has given us. Hear the tradition that has been handed down to us. Share in our experiences of God's grace this season. And together, we will come to know, understand, and reason together how we can hold tightly to that light of God's light and God's grace of hope together. Let's pray. Gracious Father, Lord, we thank You for how You have given us promises, symbols of light in the darkness of life. Father, we thank You for sending Your Son, sending the Christ child, for becoming human, for living with us, and for saving us, redeeming us from sin and death. Lord, in our hearts, may our hearts be warm this Advent season. May it not just be another ordinary season, but may we be transformed by the light of Your grace. And as we learn and hear the stories and characters of Narnia, characters like Aslan, may we be able to learn more about who You are in our real world. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, bud. Let's close our service with one more hymn. I know we have Holy Communion in the bulletin this morning, but I got my weeks mixed up. It's not the first Sunday. I just thought first Sunday of Advent. Well, we're supposed to have it, but actually next week, and we might actually hold off until Christmas Day before we receive communion. So, let us close our service with our final hymn, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. It's on page 240 in your hymnals. I'm not sure if we have the lyrics on the screen, so page 240 in your hymnals.
Joyful, all ye nations, rise and stand.
and in the light of God's grace, and of the light and grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and in the love of God, and with the communion of the Holy Spirit, may it be with you all, now until He returns. Amen.
Amen.
You are dismissed.
Thank you.